I want to wish all fathers a happy Father's Day before I begin the message. And this greeting of happy Father's Day refers to me too. And I'm speaking today as a father to a pretty young lady. So this morning I was down at the open service. But when Pastor Grace introduced me, she was saying that probably I am a better person to speak on Father's Day than her because I have got two young ladies as my children. And I want to start by saying that it takes only moment of romantic passion to become a father. Doesn't take that much. So, of course, I'm not focusing on that. But my message is about the other part. That it takes a lifetime of loving, perseverance to be a good father. And my message today is a message for everyone, for fathers, for would-be fathers, for the wives who may want to see the father from a father's perspective, and especially to the children who actually may not really understand father's heart. And I have two daughters. I have no son. So I used to teach with my teachers in school. Most of them are all ladies. And I always, when it comes to children, their eyes will sparkle, this mother. And there's been once or twice they asked me, "Wow. So, Mr. Koi, what do you think? Boys or girls? What do you think about them? Which one is having girls or having boys? Which is better?" Sometimes it's just teacher. And I always say, I think girls are better than boys. And for those who have boys, and I have one teacher who has two boys, she's not very happy. "Mr. Koi, why you say girls are better?" Answer is because I have two girls only, right? So then this was from my mother, not from my father. My mother says to whether it's a boy or a girl, it's all the same. That she loves everyone equally. So here is where I want to ask just this question. For 1 hour, I'm trying to answer this question. What are the two characteristics that you would pick to define a good father? So, in a world where we live in, we celebrate success, we celebrate status and all that, maybe some of you may think, "Oh, a good father must be someone who is wealthy." But is that true? You can try to ask children whose fathers are wealthy. Of course, a wealthy father can be a good father if he has the two characteristics that I'm talking about. But wealth is actually not an indicator of the potential to be a good father. If you try talking to this rich teacher, it may say, you ask it. The conversation may go this way. Father is very wealthy. Why, you have a very good father. No, you can buy anything you want. He says, "Yes, my father, I want a headbag. Buy a headbag. I'm finding a neighbor's headbag. I want anything you buy for me. Yes, I can do anything I want. Which one you can buy? All this." Then, is your father good? I really don't know. I only see him once a year. So you will find wealth doesn't really capture that, a sense of being a good father. Of course, some people will say, a good father must be an intelligent person. Is that true? Let us ask the kid. Your dad, very smart, you know. Every time we are with your dad, and then your dad is like super intelligent. I see him with people, or he's always number one. Oh, you talk to the kid. The kid will tell you, yes, my dad is very intelligent. My dad always is number one of the people. He knows everything. Is your dad good? Well, I don't want to say whether it's good or not, but I don't talk to him. Why? He's always right. Just listen. No need to talk. So, I was actually thinking, too smart that then may not be too good. And you may have this response. I wish my dad was a little bit more open. Not too good. So, I want to let you think about those characteristics that we sometimes think of. We see a person's father that is rich, and you think, oh, your father will reach how nice he will be. You see a father that's very intelligent, and your own father doesn't know that much. You think, how nice my father is also like that, respected. But I want to let you know, those characteristics do not define a good. And the two characteristics, I work on the first one, and I want to work on Psalm 103, verse 13. In Psalm 103, verse 13, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. Here, the psalmist, David, tries to describe the characteristic of compassion that God has for his people, for his children, by taking the example of a father's compassion for his children. The Hebrew word, the compassion here, is actually defined as a strong love which is rooted in some kind of natural bond. And it is a love that has a sense of two parties, where one party is in a more superior position than another one. If I want to break this up, it's trying to say this word compassion from the Hebrew tells us it's a very strong love. Then this word compassion in Hebrew also tells us there is a natural bond, like father, son, mother, daughter. And this word tells you that it is not in Hebrew to be used between friends. It is to be used between someone with a certain status above the other. So it is ideally used for parents and children. So here, this is the father's love. That the father loves his children with a father's love. And this is the first defining characteristic of being a good father. Now, when we say the word father's love, the definition is one thing. But how is it expressed out? You will find that all those children who are around, present, you really think you will find that the father is someone who actually cares for the children's welfare. In fact, you will find that these are things that younger children may not be able to realize. For example, if you are in primary school, underage job, you may not really be able to appreciate how your father actually goes through the stresses and challenges of being at work. It's not easy to be an employee these days. The quotas that you have to meet, the work commitments and all that, to put food on the table. table. You got dinner time, but all these takes an effort, takes a toll on your father. And beyond that, you will find that there are so many other things that the father needs to do to care for the family which you are not aware of. Now, when you reach your teenage years, you go from age 13 down to probably age 19, 20, 21. You may start to know, my father works in his job, my father does certain things and all this. But I think these days, many teenagers take all these things for granted. When they have a problem, and they call the father, they expect that the father will immediately come and solve the problem, and they take it for granted. Sometimes they do not realize how much time and effort the father needs to take. Sometimes the sacrifices the father needs to make in order to make the thing work for the youngster. Then I always say, when do people slowly grow to appreciate what the father does? The only time is when he becomes a father himself. Yes. You can get him to work, he will improve a little bit. But unless and until he becomes a father himself, he will not be able to really appreciate the father's love. And here, we are also caught in between. We are mainly an Asian community. And the Asian community, of which the Chinese is a large part, in Christian circles, you will find we all come, especially in the Asian community for people our age. And things are changing. But for people our age, I can ask you all, people our age, so young people, you won't be able to really practice. When can you remember your father hugging you when you were young? I don't know how your father did. My father never did, okay? So, why? It's because it's not that my father doesn't love me. It's just not the thing. You watch movies. Like Wong Fei Hung. You watch those Chinese movies. You have scenes like that. Father comes out. And every time the father comes out, you will see when it comes to the son, the father will always speak down to the son. It is Wong Fei Hung or whoever the father is. This. Then the son goes out from the family home and he burns and goes, why do my father is like that? But after the son goes out, and the father goes into his room and talks to the mother. Worry for my son. You know, what can we do to try to help him? You see, that's a Chinese movie you will watch. And it's true. They don't show it. That's why sometimes in the Asian community you find that the picture of the father. So, this is a message to the younger people. If your father is around my age, maybe just within the 10-year range, younger than me, a lack of expression of love is not a sign of the absence of a heart. Your father loves you. It's just that our older generation, we actually express it differently. You can ask my children. I cannot naturally hug them, meaning that I don't normally. When Rebecca wants to go down to KL and all this, and then suddenly she will hug me. That day, I brought the car down for her, and then after that, I spend an all detail, you know. I am concerned. Maybe she don't know how to press that start stop. Maybe she doesn't know how to know where the wiper. everything, know that she knows how to do it. And then suddenly, you know, and then suddenly she gave me a hug. And then, oh, pleasure, okay, my good. See? So you see, I am like that. But praise God. They, because it's their young people, they're very expressive. And I think things are also changing, you know. And it's good to have that expression. But here, the message to the young people is, people our age, we love our children. Your father loves you. It's just that sometimes he has his own way of expressing it. And here is where it's also the movies, it's also the Western culture. Sometimes things are actually moving in a direction where the understanding of a father's love is evolving. And I think that sort of understanding is evolving in certain instances in the wrong direction. Because when they talk about father's love, the emphasis is on the softer side. The softness of love, the tenderness of love, the bonding of love, the gentleness of love, all that is valid. But you will find it's what you see in the movie is how Western culture perceives love. You love your child sees gentleness, your child sees tenderness, your child sees all those softness that exemplify love. I think the Westerners wouldn't be able to understand when they see an Asian father taking out a cane and then wallop the children. And how many of us, our age, can honestly say we have not really experienced a cane before? I think almost all of us. Myself, I did, but very few times. Very few times, as I said before, very few times. And I have to say this. My brother is here, my younger brother's family is here. But I have to say this. I am with another brother. That brother gets it more than me. And he gets it harder than me. And it's not because my mom didn't love it. It's because he never really understood my mom's heart. My father, he doesn't train us. There's only once I was jumping on his bed and he was so tired. That morning I was 7 years old, 6 years old. I like to go and disturb him. Then sometimes I go to jump. And he told me that he took a cane, but I run out of the room. So now, parents are like that. The heart is for you. I understood my father's heart. I understood my mother's heart. When my mother aims my brother will stand. He is thinking I'm wrong. And then my mother look. Boom again. Still no reaction. Boom, another one. I just I'm very different. Even before the thing touches the flesh, I can tell you, I can sense the thing coming down and suddenly slowly, because before it could touch the flesh, there was the streak of pain. Then my mother will do that. Next time don't do it, huh? Then every time we'll go into the room, take a brother and me. Then I always have that scene. Why are you doing this? Do this. He said, I'm not wrong. He's not that wrong. Okay, you see, all my stuff. But what I'm trying to put to you is, that's another side. That's another spot. That love, the point of love, kind of love has a softness, a tenderness to one side of the coin. But to be a good father, you must exhibit the other side of the coin, the firmness, the discipline, the strictness. And this is found in Ephesians 6, verse 4. If you look at Ephesians 6, verse 4, you see the Apostle Paul writing about family life. And in verse 4 of chapter 6 of the book of Ephesians, Paul writes, "Fathers, do not exasperate your children." As much as it's Father's Day, I want to be real. Our relationship as fathers to our children, there is a symbiotic relationship. It's interdependent. This means how we act to our children will actually determine how our children react or respond to us. And Paul saw all this. So he wrote, "Fathers," he starts with this, "do not exasperate your children." And here is best translated, "do not act unreasonably to your children. Do not discipline your children in anger but in love. Do not take a stance where the stresses you have, the burdens you have, you bring it down on the children. Do not exasperate the children because you are able to." So here is Paul's conditional warning that your relationship with your children as a father, make sure you do it in love. Make sure you do it reasonably. And after that, Paul goes, instead, Paul says, don't try to act on your own whim, your own way. And instead, Paul says, bring in God. And this is where many of us may not realize that is where we draw our strength and our potential as a father. It is from God Himself. He says, bring them up in the training and instruction of the Lord. That the father has a responsible role. That beyond the tenderness, the father is responsible for training the child. The father is responsible for instructing the child in the ways of the Lord. And here is two sides of it. And when we are talking about training, training is discipline. That is why I'm not recommending you go out and buy again. I never train my children also. But there must be a firmness in the way we deal with our children. The things that need to be corrected has to be corrected. Things that need to be rebuilt have to be rebuilt. Because we are thinking about how he later on will grow up. And here, the question we want to ask is, how do we then discipline our children? How do we train them? What manual does the Bible actually have? And here, the Bible is very clear. The manual is the Word of God. And in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, it gives us this comfort that when we are using the Word of the Lord in our training of our children, then God is in it. For in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16, the Apostle Paul writes, "All Scripture is God-breathed and is useful." Scripture is useful for teaching. And in this instance, I am saying, as a father, the Scripture is useful for teaching your children. So spend time with them on the Word of the Lord. When you have to discuss with them anything, the Word of the Lord is your reference. When they ask you whether something is right or something is wrong, you don't try to think whether the Americans think it is right or the Chinese think it is wrong. It is whether God thinks it is right or God thinks it is wrong. And your children will grow up with a moral backbone. And here, the next verb is for rebuking your children. Which means that when your children do something that is really against the Word of the Lord, there is a place. In fact, more than a place. It is the responsibility of the father. Actually, can parenthood put this way. It is first the responsibility of the father and not the Sunday school teacher. The Sunday school teacher does a good job. The Sunday school teacher is helpful. The Sunday school teacher will set your children and encourage them on the ways of the Lord. But finally, when it comes to rebuking, telling your child, once it grows up to a teenager, that what you are doing is not right, that you have turned away from those things, because if not, then Genesis 4 comes, see not at all. This is the role of the father. And the next verb is, the father is the one who is supposed to correct the child. Even when you rebuke, then he says, so, if this is wrong, then what do I do? You don't leave him in limbo. You tell him, this is not what you should be doing. Then, this is what you should be doing. So, the child is very clear. So, there is teaching, there's rebuking, there's correcting. I want to say that I've met quite a number of instances where the father is a chief rebuker. To rebuke, number one. But, to correct, zero. So, all the child hears is, you should not be doing this. This one is wrong. That one is not right. Finally, the child comes and says, I know why it's not right. But I do not know why it's right. You have to correct. If you tell the person what you're doing is not right, you must at the same time tell your child, this then is what you should be doing. You cannot assume that your child will pick it up. He knows what's not right. Then suddenly, you know, these days, the world is no longer in black and white. Even gender is no longer black and white. I'll give you an example. You know, these days is very difficult. Last time, you can tell your child, you know, your young man is growing up. You can tell your young man, you know, you have to get married. Good enough. One fine day, 5 years later, your young man brings the spouse home. I'm married then. And then you suddenly say, tells you the spouse name is John. Not Donald. These days, a lot of things, I'm giving you an example. That now these days, there is it is just an example. In all many other areas, you will have areas in which there needs to be clarity. So when you correct, you have to correct with clarity. I'm a math teacher, and clarity comes from me being trained in mathematics. So in mathematics, 1 and negative 1, the Form 1 student that first looks into it doesn't know the major difference between 1 and negative 1, they think it's just a line. There's a big difference. So correcting, and then the word training comes to us, and the focus is in righteousness. Father is to train, to teach, to rebuild, to correct, using the word of God, using scripture, so that his child can grow up in righteousness, in the ways of the Lord, in godliness, in faith, in hope, in love, in the things of God. That is the other side of the coin. That a father cannot just be mushy-mushy, you know, everything okay. The biblical understanding of father's love is twofold. That on one side is the soft side. On the other side, the firm and the strict side. That is why Proverbs says you have to train your child in the way that you should go. So you will find, here I have put it like that. To answer the question, what are the two characteristics that define a father? One is love, and the other is discipline. And here is where I say, a father must have a loving discipline or a disciplining love. And you will find you will actually capture the heart of God. And now, I want to develop a little bit about love is because I find that many young people do not realize how much their father really cares and loves them. I repeat, many young people do not realize the sacrifices that the father makes, the concerns that the father has, the prayers of tears that the father has for them. Because all that is done in the cross. And today, I want to let you know this. If you are an obedient child, if you are growing in righteousness, if you are doing well in your studies, if you, to a certain extent, your father is naturally proud of you, then you will find the expression of a father's love becomes very easy to grasp. I mean, the rich father wouldn't like to love a child like that. Now, what I'm trying to ask is this. What about a wayward child? What about a wayward son or a wayward daughter? What about a child who actually doesn't subscribe to your expectations? And this is what I want to focus on for the next 20 minutes. And I want to let you all know, the Father's heart is something that goes beyond what the child does. Many children think that if they actually perform better in their studies, then the father will love them more. It is not true. They think that if they are more successful in life, that the father will love them more. It's not true. You will find that a father's heart goes beyond all these circumstances. I take my example. I'll share my life. I've got two daughters. Rebecca is down in Kira. When Esther is here. I can safely tell you they are not the prettiest ladies but the most beautiful ones in the whole of the world. If they are, I don't need to be faster. To come and come chow car also a lot of money. But to me, they are the prettiest ladies. They are my children. They are my daughters. The only one bigger than them is my wife. Okay, now, you have to be politically correct. What I'm going to say is, it's true. Our children, we look at them, there is that natural. They are our children. And I can let you know, I had a conversation with some of the teachers, and this started some years back. I remember it worked like that. One was very angry. And then when I saw them getting very angry, so it usually is like that. I have it. They put him, old man. So I just dropped by. Oh, Mr. Boy, you're here! I said, oh, what's that? Let's go and buy you. Hope you all. Because over a cup of coffee, yeah, things are easily settled. And you know what was the issue? They called him a parrot. And when they called him a parrot, the doctor was having some problem in school. So they called him a parrot. And then they found out that the parrot was protecting the daughter and all that, and then it got nasty. And then, it got nasty and all that. And then this teacher got very agitated. And when she read the other teacher, she said, yeah, myself 2 months ago, also the same thing. Yeah, you go about doing it. You know what they told me? I took the exercise book. Then, I took the pen. You look at the book. And months already, fucking done. No, down in the world, lazy. Yeah, how did the parent react? Parent came already to face a big black cock to school again. And he said this. Actually, my child does a lot of things very well. I think the teacher doesn't know how to teach. And my friend is a teacher. Well, then the other side said, these days our parents all protect their children. Okay, I've come now, bring some coffee first. Yeah, listen to me. So I told them to try this one. So how? Is it quite how? Okay, you try this one. The next time the parent comes, I told them this. The parent's face will be black. Look at you. I called you to school. Let's take leave from work now. Yeah, obviously here because we are concerned about your daughter. And you know, I'm not so sure which direction we are heading, you know. Then you say, your daughter is a very intelligent student. But don't lie, lah. If you ask us to put it 1 plus 2 equals 4, what do you say, lah? But many of them are! They just don't do their work! Do you know, once you say that, the parent's face suddenly starts to glow, no, black, including glow, very intelligent. He got only 8 months more to the president. And I can see that she has the potential to make it. If she just put in a little bit more work, I think she'll get quite a good grade. So when you call me to school, and you open the exercise door, problem is she hasn't been doing well. Don't say she's lazy. That one is that this word, the blackness will come back. She hasn't been doing the work. Now, the parents say, oh, really, huh? Yeah, actually, we work a little bit. Schoolwork, you try to look what the problem is, you work on your side. I think, I wouldn't say she can get it. She has a potential for at least a 3 plus. I can tell you. So, teacher, what do you think I should do? Go and buy a game. What I'm trying to say is, why? Parents are naturally, their kids are the best. It's natural. So when you approach your parent, pastor included, I raised 2 children, when you approach me about my children, so I'm trying to say, that's the father's love. Children, the father at the end of the day, children's welfare, the children, their love for the children, they are always benevolent for you. That is how God works. God favors us as His children. And we favor our children as a father. Now, here is where I want to answer this question. What about a wayward child? You will find the Bible has 2 instances that address the wayward child. One is a parable. And then the other is a real life incident. I want to begin with the parable first. It's a common parable, the parable of the prodigal son. Now, if you look at Luke chapter 15, then you see the Bible's answer. And the Bible's answer here gives us a glimpse of the Father's love. I don't want to begin with verse 19. Of Luke chapter 15, verse 19, I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired men. This verse 19 goes like that. Of course, everything begins from verse 11. You have this man with 2 sons. The elder one supposed to be the better one, more obedient. The younger one was
disobedient, he asked to divide the property, it was a bad thing to do. The father had to relent, given the property, he squandered everything away. Came a time, he thought the money could last. That is why the Chinese have a saying that the money cannot last you 3 generations beyond that. That's what happened to him. Even in his time, he squandered everything. There was a famine. He had to go to work probably the first time in his life. He went and he found how difficult it was to be employed. He suddenly grew up from there. That's why sometimes I tell parents, if your children are proud, they are abusive, they do not know how to honor parents, they are disobedient, wait till the boss disciplines them. If they say the same things to the boss, equivalent to the things they say to parents, to those who are disobedient, you think the boss will say, you know, so how are, the boss said tomorrow no need to come to work, right? Really? You will grow up. And here, and at the end of the day, the higher pen, the intent of the big sky and all this, finally, one power Sunday, he set up and said, hey, hello, the pigs are eating better food than me. Because he was hungry, starving to death. Then he says, I have to go back to my father. And it was in his mind. He says, I'm going to tell my father, I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me one of the highest servants. You must understand, when he went, he was thinking to ask the father, can I be a servant in the house? Now, it goes on like that. Verse 20. So he got up, went to his father. Verse continues, but while he was still a long way off, father saw him. His father saw him and was filled with compassion for him. The love of the father. No matter what the son did, the father still loved him. The father was the one who ran to his son, threw his arms around him, kissed his son. And in verse 21, the son memorized this, so he just did the same thing. He told the father, I have sinned against heaven and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Verse 22, but the father said this, bring the rope. Bring the ring. Put ring on him. Bring sandals. Bring the fattened cow. Bring calf. We are going to kill it. We are going to feast and to celebrate. And verse 24. That's the father's heart. For this son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he is now found. The interpretation of this parable has often gone the line of evangelism, on the line that God loves all sinners. Today, I want to take this to appropriate God's fatherly love to the father's love. And they say, so they begin to celebrate. This son of mine was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. So here, I'm speaking to young people. I'm speaking to the father. And I want to encourage the fathers, as you draw the father's love from God the Father, your call is always to express that love to your children in the way you deem fit. And one fine day, God will touch the heart of the wayward child. To the wayward son or the wayward daughter, you must always remember, your perspective of your father is far different from the realm. Often you may think, after all that I did, my father will not accept me. Let me encourage you. Your father will accept you with open arms because God made the father free. And from this parable, I want to give a real-life incident from the OT, which I drew from about 4 years ago in a Father's Day message. It's been quite a while. So I picked it. I think many of you may remember that when I preach
Father this day's message, I grounded it on the fact that the fullest expression of the Father's love in the Bible as expressed in the lives of the Old Testament saints is found in 2 Samuel chapter 18, and it is in verse 33. You cannot find a better incident that captures the Father's love. And David could have it because David was a man of the God's heart. And that expression of him for his son Absalom was reminiscent, was so close to the way God sees us and the way God loves us. In 2 Samuel chapter 18, verse 33, the verse goes, the king was shaken. King David was shaken. He went up to the room over the gateway and he wept. As he went, he said, oh, my son Absalom, my son Absalom. If only I had died instead of you, oh, Absalom, my son. Now, the beauty of this passage, the beauty of his reality did not lie in the verse per se. It lay in who Absalom was. I can let you know, if you have an obedient son, if you have a righteous, if you have a responsible son, and if that son were to meet with a misfortune, and if you cry like that, my son and my son, it would not be anything very unique because he was so close to you. He was so responsible. He was so righteous. He was a good son. But do you know this Absalom, who he is? I just cannot debate from using the Hokkien. That's what the Hokkien says. He's someone who was wayward. How wayward was he? You read the first two, the chapters 17, 16. He caught an army, declared himself king, ran after his father. He wanted to actually, we really don't know to what extent, but he ran after his father to arrest his father. He came against his father. David heard it. David ran with a small army, 200. But along the way, David's army regrouped. And when he regrouped, the army faced Absalom's army in one major battle. And in the tens of thousands of the army, in front of the whole army, David the king told Joab the commander, be gentle on my son Absalom. And what did Joab do? In the midst of the battle, Absalom's army collapsed. Absalom ran. His head got caught in the branches of the tree. He was hanging there. Joab's soldiers went there, surrounded him. Look at him. Joab came along and said, hello, what are you all doing? Look at him. Spear him. And they say, the king already gave a command to the whole army. We are to spare the young man's life and to bring him back alive. Joab went and speared Absalom. Before we want to go into the details of why Joab did it, of course, it's a personal clip, but I want to say we have to be fair to Joab. Joab knows this principle. Absalom, the son, will win and will most likely rise up again. Chinese dynasty history, even Indian dynasty histories, are actually full of incidents. The father will always spare the son. But it is always the son who will have no qualms at certain times to slaughter the father. You read Chinese history, you can know the sun rises up, then the sun's army is demolished, the sun is captured, and the counselors are saying, you have to kill him. The father looks at the son, and those wayward sons, they have one way of looking into the father and say, I am your son. And then the father says, I send you to the exile. Don't come back anymore. I don't want to see you. And what does the wayward son do? He goes out to the frontier and he collects an army. But the next time, he makes it, and the father is in front of him, and the father says, I am your father. This is Bhagavad Gita. Even the Indian one, the other one. The son says, come! Your Milan, that's it. Now, Joab slave Absalom, he was loyal to David. He had the implication. David was at the gate. Later, one man again. Surprising, the Bible just records what's in the man's heart. Did David say, did we win the battle or the war? David actually asked, is the young man Absalom safe? That was David's question. Is the young man Absalom safe? Then, that is in verse 29. Answer given by the runner, we have won the war. He didn't mention about the son, David. He wanted to know about the war. Doesn't understand us. Another one came. Same question, verse 32. Is a young man Absalom sick? And when the runner, it was Cushite, replied, may the enemies of my God, the king, and all who rise up to harm him be like that young man. That was when you find the king weeping for his baby. You can look through the Old Testament. This is the most vivid expression of a father's love for his children. Absalom was a totally wayward son. But do you know what David did? He says, if only I had died instead of you. And this verse is an atonement verse, and it reflects the Father's love for all of us. That when Jesus died on the cross, we were all like Absalom. We were all the wayward children of God. We were all the wayward people whom God created, the wayward creation. My God saying, and then I want to let you see in the heart of King David, the son's life was more important than the kingdom. And here I want to encourage the young people. You can never really grasp how much life loves you. And here, I want to encourage the fathers, even as we relook Psalm 103, from where I started. And in Psalm 103, it is pertinent and it is right to try to work on this comparison. David wrote very concisely, as a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. That God's love is intertwined in some form with man's love. That the father's love is something that has its source in God's love. And I want to encourage the fathers, if you have difficult children, more you grow in the Lord, the more your intimacy with God grows, the more you will have the expression of a father's love, as David expressed to Absalom. So now, it is Father's Day, and one last word of encouragement to the fathers. This, I don't want to look the left. Look the right. This is an answer to this question. Actually, what does my father want from me? There are some children who ask like that. Then, why my father like that? I give you one verse that solves everything. See, I told you about how I understood my mother's heart. It worked. It works. So you must know Father's heart. And it is the first three verses of Ephesians 6, verses 1 to 3. This is a message to the young people, also a message to the middle-aged ones. You know, go back to your old father and remember him. Children, Ephesians 6, verse 1, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. And verse 2, honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with a promise. And verse 3, that it may go well with you, and that you may enjoy long life. It is a blessed man who honors his parents. And the three verses are very clear. The father doesn't want you to be the best doctor, doesn't need you to be the smartest person. The father's heart is drawn. If you ask a father, Dad, what do you want of me? Unless you marry a gambling debt, father sign me a check for 50,000 and then you will run off of the house, right? But barring that, he can let you know. Your father may not express it, I express it for him. Your father says, if you are a little bit more open to him, then respectful to me, I will be happy. We are just a little bit more obedient and respectful to me. That is already my prayer answer to young people. Respect your parents. To young people, even though you may be 16, 17, 18, 19, even 20, I want to let you know, your parents have gone through the thick and thin of life. Listen to them. Be obedient. There will come a time when you are fully to make your own decisions. The time is not when you are 13 years old or 16 years old. The time will come later on. But while you are under your parents' care, especially if you, before you, Daddy, you got 50 ringgit or not? You are under your parents' care and still watching, listen to them. But the day you find a phone job, living in Singapore, whatever, God requires you to make own decisions, the day has not yet come. So, be obedient and be respectful to your parents in the Lord, for this is right. I care to say that for many of us fathers, this morning, right now, I think it would be a wonderful prayer answer. We pray, and then our children touched by the Lord, and you find that they follow us and they are obedient, I think it is more than enough. So, I have to take this message from the viewpoint of a father, from the viewpoint of a teacher, from the teacher's viewpoint, I see and I related with young people who do not have a good relationship with their fathers. From the viewpoint of a father, I want to let all the young people know your father loves you for who you are. Other people may look to you according to your gifting. For the father, that is not important. He just loves you because you are his son or you are his daughter. So, I think it's a good time. I want to get the father's help. Can the father's help come out? I want to pray for all of you. Then the rest of us can just arise and we just pull our hands out as I pray for the fathers. So can the fathers come out? And if you have forgotten that you are a father, then we will go and pull you out.